Dear friends, the current session, our main speaker, I actually congratulate Dr. Swami and VHS leadership to select this topic. Not more than selecting this topic, they found the most apt speaker to deal this subject. RVS Mani. RVS Mani was undersecretary in Home Ministry for a long time, and when 26/11 attack happened, and he was actually in charge of the internal security of the country in the undersecretary level in charge. He is the basic preparer, collecting informations and alerting to the secretary level officers and to the ministry level officers. And RVS Mani, you people should buy RVS Mani's has wrote a wonderful book, Myth of Hindu Terror. RVS, you can have buy it through online, and because most of the sensitive books, India's publishing sector is basically like media, there is a left high-handedness is there. Certain books, they won't, that distribution network will not support. That happens to our Sri Iyer's NDTV frauds also. Because...
No, it is not his fraud.
No, Sri Iyer's NDTV frauds. So, but now the internet is available, you can look into RVS Mani's book, Myth on Hindu Terror. Every people should read it, because how the system, Home Ministry and the national security works, and how a Hindu terror was created, because Mani explains a lot how it happened, how Digvijay Singh controls the ministry. When Shivraj Patil was the Home Minister, Mani was asked to explain to Digvijay Singh, and Digvijay Singh, and that time there was an IPS officer who was Hemant Karkare, was also sitting there asking Undersecretary RVS Mani, what is your opinion on a blast at Nanded? Mani said that our information is, it is industrial blast, it is not a public issue, Neita, it is a factory blast. Then they said that, no, no, it is a Hindu blast, you look into it. The factory owner was earlier RSS, go into that. That was the first Hindu terror created in the Home Ministry files from 2006. I think Dayton and others, RVS Mani Saab will tell, because he is crystal clear on Dayton, this thing. And then this Nanded blast went to CBI, and later it turned out to be a simple factory blast. How they created? Because why my assessment, I am still covering Home Ministry. My assessment was 2009 Lok Sabha election, Congress leadership was trying to create Hindu terror and paralyze the RSS and Hindu leaders. I remember in 2008 it came out very quickly by around 3 o'clock. All news, first everything starts in NDTV. Hindu terror knocks the top RSS BJP leadership. Flash was going for half an hour saying NIA has unearthed, that ATS has unearthed the role of top RSS leadership. Then they plan media straight away goes to none other than Yogi Adityanath saying that your name is involved, you are then. But he, being a bold man, he simply said that, Himmat hai to aajao. Himmat hai to aajao. Then that went, then it went to Indiresh level. Then every time Home Ministry will tell us, day after tomorrow, we will summon Mohan Bhagavat. But everything collapsed after anti-corruption, 2G gone, blown off, and the official started saying no to these politicians. And 26/11, Mani Saab will explain. Some things media, Indian media has not did it. Because how Pakistan fooled the India's top home ministry security apparatus. November 24 or 25, Indo-Pak home secretary level talks were happening in Islamabad. And they told all our home officers, including home secretary, we have a meeting with our home minister, let us take some time. And they took all Indian officials, including home secretary, to tourist hill destination, Mari. When blast was happening, India's entire security system was enjoying life in Mari, Islamabad Mari. And then only RVS Mani was the top officer handling India's control room. He will explain how all these things got delayed, and he will explain where the coordinations, our system, and he will explain. We all have to learn one, we have to always alert as dutiful citizens, how 26/11 or all Mumbai blasts, where there is a local support basis there. Just Pakistanis straight away not coming and blasting. They have a clear cut back, sleeper cells are there. I think the concept of sleeper cells in this CA, later CA demonstrations and others, there is a role of sleeper cells everywhere. RVS Mani, I'm leaving to RVS Mani sir, please listen to his word by word, and we can only request Mani sir, be free, there is no issues, this is free, you can put all your life in home ministry, 26/11, Hindu terror, everything. Now I leave to you this mic, so enjoy.
Respected Dr. Swamiji, many people who have been friends with me, like Mr. Shri Iyer, who is an erudite writer and running the hangout, I have done a lot of hangouts with him. MRV, others, all illustrious people, Chandralekhaji, whom I respect. I'm very happy to be amongst with you to share my experiences of what happened, because some sort of a curtain raiser has already been stated by the person comparing this session, Mr. J. Gopikrishnan. But the in-depth facts I will put before you for your own consumption, how you take it, how the myth was sought to be introduced into as a Hindu, as a terrorist. I have already written it in the form of a book called Myth of Hindu Terror. And let me confess that Mr. J. Gopikrishnan has a role to play in publication of this book. When I wrote the first script, most of the publishing houses in India did not want to publish it. Then a common friend introduced me to Mr. Gopikrishnan, and his neighbor, who is in publishing business, agreed to take this book. So that was my first victory, and I am always indebted to Mr. Gopikrishnan for this. And not just my personal gratitude, but the nation is indebted to him, because the contents which otherwise would have been buried in government files and documents have been brought to the fore of public domain. More importantly, in the said book, any reader, any person would have read the book, would have surely said that I have tried to basically tabulate the documents, and that itself draws the conclusions. More and more of reliance on documents have been there, the government systems, the procedures, etc. have been there. And whatever is quoted here is verifiable. either through documents on public domain or they can access the RTI, and many of them have already come on the public domain through RTIs. I always believe, or rather it's a fact, that the security agencies and the diplomacy are as good as the political leadership allows them to be. Here I would take you to the very successful event which happened on 30, I'm not going into the Hindu terror angle now, 31st December 2014, there was an attack on the Gujarat coast by the same pattern, the same group of ISI sponsored terrorists, and it was neutralized, preempted and neutralized. If you see the contours of that, the Indian Coast Guard and the Indian Navy neutralized it. If you see the contours of that, it was very, there was little to choose. There was no difference between what happened in 2008 and 2014. But the political leadership was the basic difference. And so we had averted a terror attack, another terror attack through the coastal area. In the security establishment, they say intelligence is a force multiplier. Force multiplier. So shall we say, either out of complicity or out of incompetence, if the political leadership is weak in maths, then the multiplications could be very, very bad. And that's the difference. The basic difference is 26/11 happening and 2nd January 2015 not happening. That is a simple one. That's the reason I said that if the arithmetic is bad, either out of complicity, intent, or out of any design, we end up losing 167 people vis-a-vis saving all of them. Besides the loss in economy, loss in critical human resources, loss of face, so many other attendant consequences. 26/11 indeed could have been averted. I will take you to P. Chidambaram's statement in the Lok Sabha. He made a so motu statement on 11th December 2008. Actually, the 10th December was the winter session convened, and by first day being obituary reserved for obituary residents, 11th December he agreed to give this statement. And if you read the statement very carefully, he said that the Indian Navy had sighted the hostile ship in Pakistani. We had intelligence inputs on this coastal attacks. We had shared it with the principal director of naval intelligence and the Coast Guard, and they had also sighted the ship in Pakistani waters. Subsequently, since further intelligences were not coming, the Indian Navy or the Coast Guard did not pursue and they abandoned the surveillance. A very vital question comes here. Again, I say intelligence being a force player, guarding the coastal area is the basic domain of the Indian Navy. They don't lower the surveillance after having seen a hostile element in even in Pakistani water, backed by a intelligence, previous intelligence. They don't lower their guard, they don't de-escalate. Then what happened? It's a very vital question. What happened that the Indian Navy abandoned the surveillance as per P. Chidambaram? This is a very vital question. There may be security experts on this. A basic confirmation or corroboration may be obtained from that once a hostile thing is sacked, they never lower it. In fact, they escalate the surveillance. So this is one of the biggest lies Mr. Chidambaram had peddled. As a consequence of that, from 23rd, they came into Mumbai, they attacked us and brutalized us and went back, or passed away, or became fidaeens, or whatever it is. That is number one question on this. Another very important thing, Mr. Gopi Krishna has already detailed on that the Indian security establishment was in Pakistan at that time. We were having intelligence right from middle of November, repeatedly shared with the Chief Secretary and DGP of Maharashtra, and this concurrently the Home Secretary level talks, annual Home Secretary level talks were the dates offered were 25th, one day talks were offered. In this context, I will take a small diversion from the route. This Home Secretary level talks or the composite dialogue or the Aman Singh, Aman Ki Asha are always a farce in my experience. On when it was held in 2006 in Islamabad, before the Indian delegation could come back, RSS headquarters were attacked in Nagpur. And that was a very interesting day in the book also, because that is where I was exposed to the plan to peddle this myth of Hindu terror. In the room of Mr. Shivraj Patil, when I kept on saying that, sir, in my limited exposure, I have no evidence of a Hindu terror. The Home Secretary and other officers are expected to land by 4 o'clock. From Islamabad, you can always assess them. But Mr. Digvijay Singh kept on hammering. Mr. Shivraj Patil, I would always, whatever interaction and whatever involvement he has been, we always used to name him as an unattached home minister without any involvement. Like in differential law, they say some MPs are unattached without any commitment to the government. We used to call him an unattached home minister. Only Digvijay Singh and other people were running the ministry, and this is a fact. This I have explained. And Digvijay Singh kept on interrogating me, mining for information. Technical support was provided by that IPS officer who was present there, whom after 26/11 happened, I came to know that was Hemant Karkare, who has become a martyr. But it's a fact that these two people had started the plan of peddling the Hindu terror, and RSS headquarters happened. So they were a little anxious that this Islamic terror is getting caught up, so we should have a counter narrative. That is what I said. When I told my senior officers that this happened, one officer in fact asked me, why did you answer to Digvijay Singh? I said, Mr. Home Minister was present there. Keta, why did Digvijay Singh ask you the question? I said, sir, it was Home Minister's room. If he had any objection, it's the Home Minister who should have intervened and said, look, don't tamper my officer. But he kept on giving very stoic silence and watching the entire proceedings. So I believe Maunam Swikarat Lakshanam, it was the tacit approval of the Home Minister, Mr. Shivraj Patil. This I had reduced it to writing and submitted for office record, whatever transpired. Later on, this Nanded April, actually what happened was whenever there was a terror attack, we would get to know of it within few hours through the IB sources and other local police sources and so many other networks. But this was an incident which happened on 20th April 2006. We were not aware of it, but after my interaction with Digvijay Singh in Home Minister's room, this Nanded issue came up as a report that there was a terror attack. Later on, the CBI, which investigated it, found that it was a case of industrial fire. Maybe deliberate, but it was a case of industrial fire. And the owner of the small workshop used to visit the Bajrang Dal office. So it was all put together and made a Hindu terror, a non-existent Hindu terror. But I am coming back to 26/11. Again, this 26, second time when the Pakistani delegation was in India, without completing the agenda, their delegation went back to Islamabad, quoting some Lal Masjid attack on 3rd July 2007. So it was never with seriousness that the Pakistanis were taking this Home Secretary level talks. And this 25th November was the date. Normally there are protocols as to Home Secretary level with Pakistan, what will be the structure of the delegation, Home Secretary level with Bangladesh, what will be the structure of the Nepal, like that, concerned joint secretaries and all. But in this case, when all the delegations are almost ready, an intervention came and another officer dealing with border management, although his junior of the concerned domain area was already there in the delegation, he was additionally included in the delegation. We thought maybe the government wants to send a stronger delegation on that, and maybe like that. But what happened in Pakistan after landing in Islamabad was very, very interesting. The Pakistanis, as is their wont, they left the agenda unfinished on 25th. Then there is a cutsy call which is made by the visiting Home Secretary on the Interior Affairs Minister, Mr. So here Rahman Malik gave the time for 3 o'clock on 26th. Two officers, of course, one officer I know, he came back on 26th morning from the agencies, intelligence agencies, advised the Home Secretary against not getting into the trap and going as per schedule and returning the 26th morning. But our additional secretary played the game, and he, because all other officers were of joint secretary level, he had de facto number two, and he clinched the issue, and the delegation decided to stay back. After 3 o'clock meeting with Rahman Malik, they were offered hospitality at Murri, where those days the communication system was not very, very effective. At 4 o'clock or 4:30 Pakistani time, they went to Murri, around 60 kilometers from Islamabad. And by 7, when they reached Murri, it was around 8:50, around time the terrorists entered India at that time, through Colaba coast. Now I come to the second part of the story. People who are living in coastal towns may be well versed with the culture of the fishermen's enclaves. In the evening time, there's a lot of celebration, merrymaking, singing, drinking and all. It's a social gathering and all that. Not just that, even otherwise, even any stranger getting into a fisherman enclave cannot go without being noticed. In this case, 10 people, all strangers, carrying arms, communication equipment, personal effects, including medicines and all, so many backpacks and all, they walk through the fishermen's enclave and reach a place called Badwar Park in the evening around 7:30, 7:45. Without being noticed is very hard to digest. Absolutely very difficult to believe. And in Colaba, people who have actually, Dr. Swami Ashwar has lived in Mumbai, in Colaba at 7:30, 7:45 to get a taxi is next to impossible in those days when there was no app-based taxis or Merus and all that. And they got 4 taxis, one to Leopold Coast, one to Taj, one to Trident Hotel, and one to CST. And best of the GPS can fail you if, especially they were not very educated. Even an educated person, it is not very easy to pinpointedly reach the location in spite of your GPS. You require some sort of a human intervention. Even that was, okay, I don't take it as a factor, but even then it's a factor. They reach their destinations and do whatever destruction they had to do it. And in Taj Hotel, we find an officer who had been privy to all the intelligence which had been shared with the Government of Maharashtra, Chief Secretary Maharashtra. She is Additional Chief Secretary, Home, Government of Maharashtra. She is present in the Chinar Hotel purportedly on a personal invitation. I don't know what personality, never came clean on that. Her interview in Mumbai Mirror on 26th November 2009, 1 year after that anniversary, she had shared this, but no personal, the details of that is not given. She was there, and after a few hours, she left that place without a scratch on her body. This we were all aware of it in control room. And she had been receiving intelligence input for coastal attacks, vital installations, five-star hotels located on the coastal area, everything. So this is a very interesting case. And she went out unscathed. We received the message also at that time that Mr. Hemant Karkare is also killed in the attack. Very unfortunate. But later on, after repeated attempt, the forensic and the ballistic reports, which were shared by many police officers informally, say that he never got a bullet fired on his chest or front side of his body. So I leave it to you for the best conclusions. But then what happens is, 26-11, after all this, two days later, the then Chief Minister, along with his star son, now the Chief Minister is no more, his star son and a filmmaker, prominent filmmaker, walk through it as if they are going to plan for a film to be made on this. I don't know what was the plan, but it had happened. It is all over the place. But during 26-11, after the terrorists had come into the place, when I received the call, I said, "Gaadi bhi mat bhejna, main pahunch jaunga." I took a two-wheeler, which was easily reachable, so I landed in my control room, took charge. NSGH deployment was ordered at around 10:15 or so, and NSG had come around 12:30. But we received a message from our Home Minister, Mr. Shivraj Patil, that the Home Minister will accompany the NSG team. I don't know what was the reason for that, but Home Minister had decided. So they were kept waiting in the Delhi airport technical area for almost 1.5 hours. Journalist Sandeep Unnithan has very detailed documented this. Because I was in the control room, I didn't know what was happening in the technical area, but I knew that they were available. And we sent a message to Honorable Home Minister's residential office. I think his additional private secretary was one Baba Nagare, saying that, if the Home Minister will take time, let us withdraw a column from Central Industrial Security Force deployed in the airport. If airport is not feasible, there is one Rashtriya Chemicals and Fertilizer in Chembur. We can pull out some from there, or there are other maybe near about public sectors, and deploy them there. There was no response received from the Home Minister. Mind you, there is no other decision maker in the office, in this internal security establishment. All others are stuck in Pakistan, and there is an issue of communication also. It is for the High Commission, I think Mr. Raghavan or Mr. D.K. Sinha, who went personally to inform them of that. And second time what happened, we said, okay, if this is not acceptable, Navi Mumbai, entire CRPF battalion is there, let us deploy them. Again, no response. At 2 o'clock, the message comes from the Home Minister's office that Saab technical area ke liye nikal chuke hai. That's all. They land, he lands in the technical area at 2:20, and then the flight takes off, maybe around 4:30 when it landed. The Honorable Minister, when it was war happening in Taj and Trident hotels and other places, the Honorable Minister wanted a protocol to be extended at the airport, delaying the coming out of the aircraft of the NSG team by another 15 to 20 minutes or maybe half an hour. And every minute the terrorists were strengthening their position much, much better. And see, already had we deployed CISF or CIF, other whatever local resource available, maybe any other food. Of course, Marcos, the decision was taken from the Defense Ministry. But otherwise, we had already several attempts were there. And what then the Home Minister did not go to the Taj also. It was the NSG team which went to Taj. And later on, only a Home Minister joined it. You can verify the records on this. This is the set of circumstances, how it was handedly handled. So we always had this inclination that something much more than what meets the eye. Now, Kasab is captured, but nobody accepts him as a Pakistan. Pakistan refused to accept him as a Pakistani national. Back channels are going on. There is an allegation that External Affairs Minister had spoken to Asif Zardari when this was happening. The government conveniently denied that the External Affairs Minister did not speak based on the phone records. But insider sources know who was the Minister of State for External Affairs and who had established channels of communication with Asif Zardari. Anybody can go and verify that a Minister of State for External Affairs is no more. So I don't think much will be gained by that. But this happened. He was a member of the Indian Union Muslim League. There was another very interesting thing. And Kasab was accepted as a Pakistani national only on 7th of January 2009. Till that time, they tried to make everything possible to dilute the issue, to deny any local. This local involvement has already been denied even in the parliament question replied by Home Ministry on 2nd March 2009. 10, a start question in Lok Sabha 78, that Kasab had confessed to involvement of Indians, but the investigators did not find much merit in that. I don't know whether they followed it up or not, but it was very evident to even the naked eye not investigating that India local help was there. Because there were several issues which might have come out had they pursued the case. We all know about David Hadley's statement before the NIA team which went there. Whatever limited knowledge of CRPC I have, the investigating officer should, or the investigating team should have gone and pursued the, record the statement. At least one member of the investigating team, apart from the other agency, if NIA was to go, fine. But what really happened was nobody from Mumbai crime branch went, and NIA team goes there, records something, and comes and submits it to Mr. P. Chidambaram, who had excised it. These are all matters of record. Excised it, removed certain portion, and submitted as a tour report. It is not a statement under 164 of CRPC. So this would not have come to light had Kasab not agreed for in-camera proceedings in the Abu Jindal case, in which even the Ishrat Jahan case was also revisited. So there several untruths were there, several honest officers were framed. 26-11, Chidambaram also said there was some issue about that. The Joint Secretary was changed on that very day after the question, because Chidambaram wanted, because certain intercepts were withheld. So Chidambaram also wanted to lie on the parliament question that all intercepts have been shared. The joint secretary said, no sir, all I have now been, sir. I have personal knowledge of it. So he was shifted out and ultimately a compromise was stuck. The same question, part E, 78 Lok Sabha, answered on 2nd March 2010. Part E, if you say, if you peruse it, it is all in the public domain. It says intercepts have been shared, not all intercepts. Intercepts have been shared with Pakistan. So this is a very eye-opener for this. Like that, I remember, like, I have been drafting this. This is how so many things have been taken away, hidden from the public domain, but there are a lot of giveaways out of this. But this Hindu terror, they also wanted to prove 2611 as a Hindu terror. I had a personal issue on this issue also, but since there is a lack of time, I didn't want to get into the detail. Only thing is, on that personal issue, the Delhi police report says, I have it with me, anybody can read it and say that at that particular time, the Delhi police station was empty, allowing the under trials and the Tosha Khana to be looted by anybody. That is what is it. So they wanted to exchange me for Kasab or whatever it is, that's a different matter. But I have the letter of Delhi police with me. Then I was sounded by IPA officers not to pursue the case. So I did not do it. So this is the extent to which they wanted to prove even 2611 as a Hindu terror. Having said that, Hindu terror, whether it is 1st June 2006, the momentum might have started. But what is most important is, very honest, excellent officers, innocent persons got to be framed in this. In Samjhota blast, Bharati Arora, who was the first responder to the aspect, she was SP Railway and Crime in Panipat. She and her inspector reached the Panipat within less than 1 hour of the incident happening, and she had given a comprehensive report about the Lashkar-e hand in footprint in that. But NIA came and they changed the entire narrative. She has also now come out on TV, it has all over the RTI. The inspector concerned has confessed that how it is all a Lashkar Taiba. It is not only that, the perpetrator had been shouting, and Arif Kasmani from Karachi, a local organized crime syndicate, he himself was claiming, saying that we have committed it, otherwise ISI won't pay him because ISI works on a supari basis. They can't hold up only these type of organized crime syndicates. So that is the level, but our government kept on saying, no, it is a Hindu terror. The ISI says, since it is a Hindu terror, why should I pay Arif Kasmani? This was a piquant situation he was in. He got it through, planted through USA. He got it planted through R&AW officers, have told me. He got it planted through United Nations, everybody, that it is the Karachi people who have done it. And our government kept on saying, no, our Hindus have done it, our Asima Ananda has done it, or Nabha Kumar Sarkar has done it, whatever it is. Makkah Masjid, the evidence is now, the verdict is out. Samjhota, the verdict is out. But most unfortunate thing is the Malegaon 2008. Let me give the timelines. 29th of September 2008, Malegaon happens. First responder is the local police. Based on evidence, they have to collect, they have to say it is not a local crime, but it's a terrorist attack. Then the mandate is given to ATS. The approval required is of DG minimum, DG police. It takes, the procedure takes at least 3 days in Maharashtra. Maybe if everybody is working with utmost efficiency and alacrity. So, the entire period, the ATS would have got the mandate not before 6th or 7th of October. Now I take you back to the July 2006 serial train blast. ATS, after collecting the evidence, took almost 5 to 6 months to arrest the accused, to get a prima facie evidence to arrest the accused. Whereas in Malegaon, I keep on saying this, Colonel Purohit was arrested on 29th, that is in 22 days flat. and Colonel Purohit is a serving officer of the Indian Army, where under Section 45B of the CRPC, a sanction for arrest has to be taken. And a sanction for arrest also requires the file to be passed through around 21 tables. I'm giving it in simple words. Till the GOC of the command or the IDS, the Integrated Defense Headquarters, clears the entire thing, it has to be around 21 to 25 tables. And if the government and most of them have to apply their mind, examine the prima facie evidence presented by the police before a sanction for arrest is given. I am not coming off sanction for prosecution, that is a separate issue. I felt that, and in the intervening period, we had we'll be right back.